Meeting to order. I think the only one not here is Ann. She may be running a bit late.
Yeah, she's in the gym with three or four children running around and waiting for her husband Josh to show.
Oh, no, I got you.
Welcome to real life.
Certainly is. Trying to keep up with the schedules of these children is just... Good evening.
All right, the first order of business, if I might, Madam Chairman, or Chairperson, is to, the board needs to get organized by your bylaws, which means that you need to elect a chair. And yeah, in the light of the fact, well, it doesn't matter, it doesn't have anything to do with each other's resignation, you need to elect a chair, a vice chair, and a secretary. So in doing that, the way that we have done it in the past is that the superintendent would take nominations for chair. Floor is open for nominations for chair of the board. Joe?
I would like to nominate Sally Carr.
Sally Carr has been nominated for chair by Joe Green. Do I have a second? Carol, a second. Do we have any further nominations for chair? Being no further nomination for chair, we will close nominations for chair and call for a vote. All in favor of Sally Carr for chair, raise your hand.
Aye.
You voted yourself. All right.
Nobody else?
Yeah. Congratulations, Sally.
Thank you for that vote of confidence. I'm not sure if it's...
It's now up to you to elect a vice chair and a secretary.
I'm not sure this is a treat.
Yeah.
It might be.
I don't know why you would say that.
It's an honor.
With Michael sitting right there.
Don't worry. We're all going to come together.
Yep. So the chairs, you need to elect a vice chair.
Now, we'll look for nominations for vice chairman of the Norfolk Board of Education. Donna?
I nominate Carolyn Childs for vice chair of the board.
Do we have a second? Jill? Do we have any other nominations? Not hearing any other nominations, I move nominations be closed. All those in favor of Carolyn Childs for vice chairman of the Norfolk Board of Education, please raise your hand.
One, two.
Carol, you vote yourself?
I did, so you might as well. All right. Congratulations, Carolyn.
Thank you.
Now, we need a secretary. Do we have any nominations for secretary?
I'd like to nominate Jill Hall.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Any further nominations?
Any nominations? We already passed that. I didn't think we had any.
Yeah.
Congratulations. Now you're going to be our secretary. Those are our officers, our new officers.
All right, that's the number three on your agenda.
Public comments.
My public comment?
You want to move the regular order of business to hear from Michael?
Why don't we do that?
The public comments, and then you won't have to wait around.
Okay.
Stay, yeah. All those in favor?
I say some stuff. Some of you have seen these things before, and some of you haven't. Is it two or three different?
Two.
Thanks. My best skill set here. You've seen this.
Thank you, yes.
I asked to come down this evening. I realize it's December, and we haven't really started budget work yet, but the Board of Finance is. And so I wanted to avoid some of the oops and gulps we had last year. And when we got to the end, 1% meant one thing to some people and something different to other people. It's the consensus of the Board of Finance that this coming year's budget there's not going to be any increases. Not in your budget, not in the town's budget, not anywhere. We do not want to raise taxes. The reason I gave you the schedule that I did is I got this as part of the package on the committee that a number of us are serving on to examine the consolidation possibilities of Colebrook and Norfolk, or what do we call it? Colefork or Norbrook. And there's some things that leapt out of the page at me, because what I've given you is comparison of budgets of the two school systems. And there are some things that are at least interesting in there. And I want you to have that so you can see, first of all, what we're looking at, and what I'm looking at, and what my board is going to be looking at. We're aware of the fact that you've had some upheaval here, in the sense of very senior teachers now retired, and you replace that senior teacher with a much lower salary person. We know that your population is down. I know about the minimum budget requirements, and we will observe the law. But we're committed to not increasing taxes at all. At all. And we had our meeting last night with Sue Dyer, and told her the same thing, which means the road budget is going to get cut. There's not going to be as much money in the road budget as it was last year. There's some other things that are going to happen that means some town services are either going to have to be curtailed, eliminated, or in some sense done in a different way. We still have some humongous bills we're paying for trucks we buy, fire trucks we buy. It's a minor thing. We're having to rent a tank truck because the fire department needs to repair its tank truck. You know, every $1,000 adds up. So, because I know that you're a new board, as you just elected your officers just now, and I didn't want to let the opportunity to go by not to raise your consciousness at this early stage. I know we're not going to get around to having public hearings and that sort of thing until late winter, early spring, but I felt it was only fair to everybody to let you know what the attitude of the Board of Finance is. And we still have $1 million unfunded pension liability. We still have a firehouse that has not been repaired and needs to be repaired. And goodness knows there are probably any number of things that also need to be done. The roads are better, but they're not as good as it could be. So, having caught you cold, I'll try to answer any questions that you may have, but I suspect that it's going to be further on in the process. And of course, as you know, we will have an exchange with you. You'll have your night with the Board of Finance, and I want to be sure that we keep all the lines of communication as open as we can, so that you can do what you need to do, which is really important.
And yes, and our mission is to provide the best education
absolutely
we can provide.
And there have been some articles in the Current, and there was some discussion about rankings of schools, so I think you need to be prepared for some criticism, not from me, but it's out there. And people are, you know, when you look at the town budget and you consider that two-thirds of the town budget is education, there are always questions to be asked. We make the same pitch to the Region 7 people. I religiously go up there every year and talk to the superintendent and the folks up there. They're, I don't know if they've finished, but they're in the midst of their teacher negotiations, which were really, really, really hard this year, because I observed up through the negotiations. I know they did mediation, I know they were successful, and I'm afraid that they're going to do arbitration. That's probably not going to be good for anybody.
Right.
Probably not good for us and not good for them. You don't have a union contract up for negotiation this year, do you?
Custodians.
We're negotiating the rule process.
Yeah. And we're, you know, we have the same thing going on
right
on the town side. Trying to think what other doom and gloom is going on in the town. This $1 million thing has got me really concerned, because it's amusing for you to know that it's not enough money for us to do a bond. Nobody wants to take a $1 million bond. We're probably going to have to go out and do some kind of commercial loan, which means we're not going to get as good a rate and not as good a term. But of the things we're going to fix that this year.
Excuse me, Mike. Could you talk a little bit about what that pension liability is?
Sure.
Just a little background.
What happened
about
what happened some years back, and I don't know if this is a right-hand, left-hand thing, but we increased somewhat the benefits for the pension for the people who are in the town system, which includes some people here, I believe. And I'm not sure that we increase the amount of money in the budget every year to cover that. And this was for a defined benefit plan, and that's the traditional plan that my parents grew up with, your parents grew up with probably, where you work for a company or an outfit long enough and you get to the end of retirement and you get a pay every month. That's a defined benefit plan. So for a while we had a problem in there in the defined benefit plan where the money coming in was not enough to really cover what you needed to invest to have the money at the end when people started retiring to actually pay itself. And the last thing you want to do is pay retirement benefits out of current income because you're in trouble.
And that was just an oversight?
I don't know. I don't know what it was, but the Great Recession killed us. Because remember the great ads, the 401k became the 201k?
Mm-hmm.
Well, our portfolio lost value, you know, 40% of the value. So you're not throwing off enough income to make those payments.
Mm-hmm.
So 4 or 5 years ago, Karen Sedak, who was an actuary, who was on the pension committee, who was on the board of finance, said, yo, we got a problem. It began in about 2007, 2008. So since that time, you may remember, I think you were at some of our meetings even, since that time, we've really increased the contribution in the town's budget to the retirement plan just to stay even, just to keep the water level here instead of up here. And even though the market has rebounded, and I think...
And it has done.
It has done pretty well. It was down to 5 points today. We still have this gaposis. Now, we have terminated the defined benefit plan. We no longer have a defined benefit plan. So the $1 million comes up in converting those obligations we have to our employees who have, you know, qualified for pension into an annuity. So we're okay in terms of day-to-day expenses for the pension, but spread out over time because they're no longer contributing to that plan, nor are we, it doesn't grow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the only way the plan to work. So a lot of that money is going to go to buy an annuity for everybody who qualified or was qualified at the time that we changed it out. And it's about $1 million.
Those are school employees or those are?
Town employees. Town retirees, town employees, some people here in the school system are under our town plan. Not the teachers. And I don't think
Secretary.
You have to work so many hours.
It's more people than I think. And the last thing you want to do, you don't want to impact education, of course. And you don't want your retirees, do you like those people in Detroit?
No.
Because that's what's happened to them. The benefits are going to be cut. So we're going to convert our obligation to pay into an annuity, and you have to buy that. So that's why I'm using the $1 million figure. Okay? Yeah.
Thanks.
I don't think it was anybody asleep at the switch so much as the economy took a nosedive, and about the same time we said, holy moly, we can't keep doing these defined benefit plans. I think the Feds are one of the last big organizations that have that. So that's a big buzzword for me.
Yeah.
It should be for you, because
you don't want us
to pass a budget that has an extra $1 million in it. Mm-hmm. The good news is, I believe, that once we get the loan set up, whether it's a bond situation or a commercial loan or heavy, we can reduce the contribution we're making now to the pension plan, because we're not running in place trying to catch up. So I think in the end, the conversion to a defined contribution plan, which is what we're doing now, will reduce the outflow by 50% of what we used to pay. It's a lot of burden on the employees, which it's just is the way the pendulum has swung these days.
The world has changed.
How big is the amount have to be to float a bond or offer?
I think if we were borrowing $10 million, we would fall over themselves to give us the money. But if you want to borrow $1 million or $2 or $3, unless you can find the bond on this place is just $2 million. There's an agency that did it, kind of thing. Sometimes we can go to the Department of Agriculture called places and get loans. But for a measly $1 million, we're probably going to go to the banks.
Yeah.
which we, the town's done it before, we borrowed money from banks before. It's just, you can't get the same rates as you can some other stuff.
But the rates are better than they used to be.
If you know somebody who wants to loan the town $1 million at a very decent interest rate, please let us know.
One of the points of confusion last year, Michael, was whatever the line item in our budget is that says pension is given to us.
Oh, that makes it, yes.
From the town, we call and say, what's, how much? And we heard about being behind, et cetera, and that we needed to catch up, and we needed to put $50,000 in addition to what we had been contributing, which I'm gonna guess was about 18. So it went from about 18,000 to 68,000.
Significant increase.
And
another 3-4.
And the percentage increase in the budget really came out to be the pension contribution.
I remember this very well.
Yeah. All right, so the question tonight is, and you may not have the answer, is what number goes in the pension line this year? Is it 68?
I remember your question now.
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to your question because we have the same problem on the town side.
I know.
From 50 to 150, and I don't like to do that. And, you know, if I can see the light at the end of the tunnel is not to train, we ought to be able to go back to where we were, more or less.
If the bond goes out,
just,
what you
just in terms of, you know, holding our own, if we're going to do the equivalent of bonding. Because what we're doing with that 50 you had to pay and the 100 the town has to pay is just sort of catch up.
Yeah. But for the board and for new members of the board, if we were to have a zero budget, if, you know, we agree we'll have a zero budget, and you don't have to make a $50,000 payment, then you have $50,000 to do what you need to do.
You may.
Right.
Or.
That's the other reason I'm here.
I mean, so it's a big.
Watch out.
It's a 2% increase at 2.5 million. That 50 makes 2% increase. So that number, our timeline, we're going to talk a little bit about budget timeline for the board. We expect that we will have finished up our budget request and be ready for the Board of Finance in early March.
That's good.
And then last year, between the submittal to the Board of Finance and the first town hearing, that number got bounced all around and it became a moving target.
I want to avoid that this year because
I
know you've taken some of my spots.
Yeah,
but we're watching.
I know.
You know, I'm aware of that. And we're not looking to put anybody out of business, but you need to look at your contracts. Mm-hmm. We're not looking to do anything to anybody to hurt them, but we're not going to increase the taxes this year. We're just not going to do it, no matter what. And those madmen in Region 7, we got no control over them. But I understand New Hartford has got a pretty hard-nosed attitude these days. So thanks for the opportunity. Congratulations on your election, by the way. You know, watch what you wish for. The lines are all communication, always open. I talk to George a lot. I always try to get the answers back. And thanks for the time tonight.
And we want to continue those lines of communication.
Yeah, so it's one budget in the end, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And we want to continue to do our mission the best way we can.
And I'm going to have to check out my set of Christmas times, too.
Yeah, boy, you're not.
This is my court time.
I know. What that time we understand.
Thank you. Good night.
You'll have to check your email, too. Michael's the only guy that you send him an email and then you call the secretary to tell her to be sure to listen to his email.
I don't blame him. It's very hard. You can't keep up with the emails. You just can't do it.
The first thing I do when I get to my office is not go read emails.
Yeah.
Me too. I agree with you.
Go find out what the heck I'm doing today. And
I'm the same way.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's very difficult, particularly when you're wild and furious. And anyway, I'm glad Michael said that, but you were a tiny bit late, and so I was going to welcome you to the table when you sat down, but we started just prematurely. I mean, we didn't start prematurely. I understood you were out in the gym.
running the rent.
Thank you, nice to meet you.
Thanks, man. Not with six over.
Right.
Previously.
I understand.
For the flat crowd.
Okay, well, we're up to approval. If there aren't any more public comments, we're up to the minutes of approval.
Okay, onward and upward here. Any other public comments? Approval of the minutes of the regular meeting, our last regularly scheduled meeting. Any comment, any?
I make a motion to approve the November 13th minutes.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Very good. And you're abstaining.
What, yes, because I wasn't here.
Yeah.
Well, you were, I was not an official member.
Yes.
Right. She wasn't,
wasn't sitting.
She wasn't, she wasn't.
Can't hear as well.
That's right.
The correspondence, which is here.
Okay. Correspondence from, let's see, we have correspondence, letter from Fire Marshal. Any explanation?
Fire Marshal does his annual inspection, and he did it again this year and has told us that we're in good shape. No fire code violations were found during the inspection conducted.
So that was still under Daryl Byrd, that's.
Yes.
Yes.
Right, okay.
He is the one.
Good.
Then we have a letter from our former chairman, E.J. Lockwood.
E.J., as you know, has submitted his resignation. I did get a call from the town clerk today to say that he's officially filed the papers there that would end his term here on the board. And I think that all of us will certainly miss EJ and his impact that he's had on not only the board, but on the school district in general.
And also, I think we'd like to thank him for all his time and effort.
Absolutely.
Everyone that sits on a board like this and our other boards are volunteers and have to do lots of work with sometimes lots of aggravation.
Yeah. Questions come up about the replacement.
Mm-hmm.
And just, we might want to
address that?
Address that under new business, perhaps, as,
yes,
as a process, and
right,
we should care to.
No, I think we should do it under new business.
Okay.
And then we have the email,
yeah,
regarding the regional school calendar.
Yeah, I just tied you guys into that email. The one of the things that came out of the last legislative session in Hartford was that there would be some kind of standard school calendar in the various regional districts around the state of Connecticut. We're in the northwest corner. Ed Connection is our regional service center. They have the responsibility, God love them, to take on trying to get everybody from almost Waterbury north and west to be on the same school calendar. Having said that, the school calendar is clearly the prerogative of the Board of Ed in all of the cities and towns across the state of Connecticut, one that they guard religiously in terms of how many days they want the kids to come to school and all that kind of stuff. Some of it has been negotiated. But anyway, the legislature said that there shall be a committee put together in each of the regional service centers. They will meet and they will discuss a regional calendar. This was their first meeting. Later on tonight, we'll be approving, I hope, the calendar, school calendar for next school year. So that's just information to the board, so you can how will that work?
Looks to me like that could be a real money saver if you're in an area with a lot of magnet schools where there's busing, which we don't seem to have a lot of here.
Yeah.
In your Hartford.
When they talk about the cost savings, it sounds like they're talking almost exclusively about transportation cost savings, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Which would apply to us. So.
Yeah. Nice idea, but never happened.
Right. Well, we're a little different.
Yeah, anyway. And a nice thank you note from Mr. Jerry Reginato, our custodian, for sending a basket to his father's wake. No late correspondence.
Okay. Correspondence. All right, Ron, superintendent's report.
Superintendent has a short report. We've already covered, the way this works for new board members is that the packet that you received for tonight's meeting is put together last Wednesday. And it's sent out to you on Thursday with the hope that you'll review it before you come to the meeting. So if there are questions that you see, you might call Peter or myself or Janet and say, geez, I noticed in the packet, blah, blah, blah. So some of the things that show up in the superintendent's report is just like a shot to you people to say, don't forget now, we have a meeting next Wednesday, it's at 7 o'clock, and we have to do this and this and this. That's what that's all about. Not everybody was aware at the time that EJ resigned, that he did resign, so that's in the report, and it's the process that we talked about, that we'll be talking about in trying to fill that position. There's a variety of ways to go. I gave you a heads up that Mike Sconyers would be coming to the meeting, just in case you wanted to bail out and say, well, maybe I could have changed my mind. It always seems to be zero. The security team. By law now, we have a requirement to put together a security team. Peter, this afternoon, shared with his faculty some security plans that he'll be sharing with you later, not necessarily right now. We have to conduct drills throughout the year. We have to have full response drills throughout the year. We'll be talking more about those after the new year starts. But one of the things that everybody seems to say in a security plan is that the best way to slow down any insane person from coming into a school building is to have a number of layers, electronic doors, vestibules, whatever. So that they would not have immediate full direct access to the school. The security team has been dealing with that. I like to say that our school is safer this year than it was last year, and it will be safer next year than it is this year. But one of the big things that we've been hassling with is this reorganization of our school entryway. You get buzzed in, we have visual contact, we can buzz you in, but once you're in, you're in. So the safety and security team has been discussing how could we reorganize the entryway into the building. And they finally came to an agreement last week as to what that reorganization would look like, where the principal's office would go, where Mary Pat would go, superintendent's office, where the business office more appropriately would go, etc. I don't believe I have the plans yet. We didn't. Is that under the security?
You told me not to. I can go ahead and get one for you.
Yeah, I think maybe after, you'll get it in the mail, but you know, it's a plan that people have agreed to. Kate Johnson, who's a local architect and who's also served on the board in the past, if you recall, we had Kate come in and offer her suggestions on how to reconfigure the beginning, the entryway. And now that we've come to an agreement, we're going to ask Kate to to come up with the specs so that if we ever get the money to do it, this is what we want you to do. We'd be able to hand to a contractor, give us a price on this. Well, Kate is going to be coming up with the specifications for doing that. And the money for that will come out of our school security grant, some of it, and probably a little bit out of our school budget. But I will give you more specific information, particularly the Buildings and Grounds Subcommittee, because they are responsible for that. I apologize for not having that here tonight, but that's going to be a big thing. And you'll have your say on it also. But the idea was that an architect would come up with the specifications. If we went out to bid and the bid came in at $80,000, $90,000, $100,000, $50,000, whatever it is, the board then would pass it on down to our friend Michael and the first select woman to say, this is a recommendation from the subcommittee to reconvene and reconfigure our entryway.
We put
it
on the town budget, right? The changes to the building go under the town budget or under the school?
Capital, major capital improvements.
Yeah, under the town budget.
Go in, yeah, roof, boiler. But there's a whole bunch of other things that are considered capital that we take care of. The gym floor is an example.
Did we put in the budget, the line item, $10,000, and we projected that we'd do it for 5 years? Didn't we want to put that in the budget?
That was in the 5-year capital improvement plan.
Okay, so we, yeah. Right.
Yeah, that was, when we submit our budget to the Board of Finance, we also attach to it a 5-year capital improvement plan to kind of give them a heads up as what
what's coming down,
the oil tank replacement, a new roof, whatever, new windows, those kinds of things. But there are, there's always been an argument in every school district across the state and country as to what's a capital improvement and whose responsibility is it. Basically, if we can handle it, we handle it rather than to argue about it. And if we can get it done, we get it done. That's the way it is. With the anniversary of Newtown coming on, there's more, again, more focus on school security and school entryways and whatever. So there'll be a lot being done on school security this year, and that will be coming back to the board. And there is the cost item attached to it. So.
You found it, Mr.
Oh, yeah, okay. As long as we have, good. Peter, perhaps, you can point out. This is the business office now. So you can kind of figure out that's it. So take it from there, Peter.
Okay. This is the current main office, principal's office. Right here is first grade classroom. This is the bridge and the main entrance. This would be a new, actually there's doors there right now, but these would become electronically operated doors that would stay locked unless the kids are arriving. We let them in, then the kids arrive, we lock that door for the day. Out here, you ring the buzzer just like you do now. Mary Pat would be sitting here. She would press the button. You would come into this area here. Superintendent's office would have a window. Mary Pat would have a window. You could kind of see people walking through. Person would come in here. This door would be one that's open all the time. And there'd be a little lounge here. I think that's a couch. This is bullet-resistant walls and a bullet-resistant window, and then a new electronic operator door here. So once you let Mary Pat let the person in, or the secretary is, they come in here. She could see them through here, talk to them through an intercom, They look calm, they look nice, it's Mrs. Childs. Press the button, they come in, sign in, do their thing, and then they're off on their way. But if they came in here, they're in this area, which is a protected area, they look agitated, they look like trouble, she would not push the button, call 911, and they would be, they could leave, but they couldn't come into the building, keeping them away from children and staff.
And there's a window in the current principal's office, but also would, same window would stay, so we'd have visibility of the parking lot and on the other side.
Outside.
So you mean from the superintendent's office?
Right, and this would also allow, Mary Pat would have windows here, so she could see out of the parking lot, so she'd have actual visual of people coming, of cars coming in, and we would know, you know, she could keep an eye out if you see somebody suspicious walking in, you'd have to let them in the first layer. So that was the recommendation, is the more visual, the better. And this was the best. We went through several changes to the plans to try to come up with what was best. And the, what kept coming up was we want more visual. We want to be able to see people coming in. Because just talking to them and seeing them on a camera is not as effective as making eye contact, being able to see what state of mind they're in, have a little conversation, and then make a decision.
So all of that costs money.
Yeah.
And the question is, well, how much money does it cost? We'll say, well, we'll have green construction, depending, give us a price. Well, green comes in and says, well, what do you want me to do? Well, this one. So Kate will have the specifications to translate that into the construction phase.
Mm-hmm.
So we give that to each of the architects, then they would submit a bid, they'd all be in the same ballpark, which of course is going to be required by the state if we're going to use their money anyway. And then whatever the big number is, we refer on moving on downtown. Now, every action has an equal and opposite reaction. There goes a classroom. And as you're sitting over there, like King Grove saying, here's their classroom. So how are we going to make that up? Well, that causes something else to happen, you know? So every, you know, we have...
Would the superintendent's office then become a classroom?
Superintendent's office, this would become, but it could be combined with that. And then if you notice, this says workroom. Right now, this is in Solo's office, and that would become our workroom, which is next door, which is a full-size classroom. So that would become a classroom again, and this would become a workroom. Rachel can sit in the hall.
I'll be relocated.
We'll have to work on that part. But
she has a good side of the
space,
workroom.
So.
George, does each school have the final authority? Does it have to go through some sort of state approval?
That was my question.
So
through all so this, do we need to get actually Daryl involved, being the fire marshal?
He's on
okay.
The,
and yeah. Michael Rose,
the fire chief, is on the on the security committee.
Right.
And Mike, yes.
And Michael Rosa for being compliant with a public building and egress and all that stuff that's associated with that.
Yeah, just
because the plan seems great, but I mean, I'm sure there's going to be some things that.
These doors do have push bars. And
right.
On
for
there's
access.
A fire,
right.
You can get out.
Mm-hmm.
And
you
I'm sure it'll cost a few bucks.
Absolutely. Everything does.
What else is
forget
it?
Something?
No, I want to comment. If anybody saw today's show, this
I did, yeah.
I know I did.
What's his name, Rosen?
And they went investigating schools in New York City.
To see how easily he could get in.
What was the comment was they said, how long does it take you to get to be recognized in the principal's office is very important.
Mm-hmm.
Because they talked how he went into one school and actually was in the building 2 to 3 minutes before he found the principal's
anybody.
Office. And he was walking into classrooms asking where it
yeah.
was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
2 to 3 minutes is a long time.
Mm-hmm.
If you're
yeah,
a
do a lot of
drugs.
Isn't it sad?
But the actually had, once they
exactly.
were in, then they were not left to find where they were going
to
their appointment, but someone physically took them there.
Yeah. The other thing that we kept hearing over and over again is time is very important. Slowing a person down. Now, what's in my experience is more apt to happen than a bad man with a gun is an irate parent with a few drinks in them that wants their kid, and I don't care what she said, and she, you know, runs down the hall and does, you know, physically abuses or assaults somebody.
Or they're not a custodial parent.
Or non-custodial.
Yeah.
I have that happen.
And the idea is that the the more that Mary and Mary Pat along and talk to the person, you know, the better feel you get for the whole thing. Now, after having gone through all of this since last August, at the last meeting, somebody came up with yet another idea that some people felt had merit. You know the bridge that comes into the school? Well, what if we, you know, did something with that so that you get buzzed in out here where the bus pulls up, and then you've got that space between the door, main entry into the school.
Which Mary Pat could see.
I mean, it's cold and hard, and it's not very welcoming, but some members of the committee thought that. And it also would define the entryway to the school, which has long been a question during my time here, you know, that we needed some kind of portico or, you know, to let people know. But anyway, so I'm not sure where this is now, but this came up late, and some of the people on the committee felt that there might be something we could do between where the bus is and the entry of the building, if we could do something there. So I passed that on to Kate Johnson as well as an idea, so I'm not sure where that's going to go.
And could it be that it might be less expensive?
That's also, but it's, you know, whatever we save on money here, if there is money to be saved, I think it's going to be, you know, not very welcoming. It might be kind of cold and can't do much with that space.
Alligators
are great. To go back. And finally, as we transition into the last item on the superintendent's report, is that the regional subcommittee meetings are out there meeting and talking about the future in terms of Colebrook and Norfolk being together. I encourage you to read those subcommittee minutes. I try to include them in everyone, but that also, you know, taking away a classroom, you know, fits into that whole dynamic as well, you know. So that's kind of some of the things that we've been talking about. So that's it. That's the superintendent's report.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Coulter. Principal's report.
Wait, Mr. Bills for approval.
I thought you'd just take care of all those bills.
Yeah, I know, but they're all paid. This is really information to you as to how we spent some of the money last month.
You know that people always have questions. But
yeah.
It's done.
So if you have any questions about what that
not
was
a lot
for,
of
this is
yeah.
Not
very many.
You have this one.
Yeah, I've done this one is. Yeah. Very interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, no questions? Moving on to our monthly budget report.
Who approved them? We got it approved. Did we approve
them? No.
All those in favor of approving them, let's have a motion.
I make a motion we approve the bills for payment.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. We're up through November on our payments, on our budget, and we're still
with great speed.
Yeah, no big surprises. Other than some unexpected legal fees that we ran into through the summer, and I don't think are over yet, but I'm not reaching for the mailbox yet. I think you're okay.
Cafeteria? Report?
Yeah. There's a cafeteria report that Janet left at your place. We've been kind of monitoring that over the last few years. And the reason for that, for new board members, is that for years, we've never put any money into the cafeteria account. It ran by itself. It was a revolving account. We got government commodities. We used those commodities, and life went on, et cetera. As the enrollment went down, as the food participation dropped off because of enrollment decline, the board has tried to make an effort to come up with creative ways to raise money in the cafeteria. And we're not doing nearly as bad as we thought we would be doing.
Which is good news.
Yeah. We're only about 900 bucks, was it? 900? In the red. Through the month of November? Is that November or October?
November.
Yeah, through November. And most of our major expenses are in health, you know, Carol and Jackie. That's just the way it is. They do a good job for us every day. Kids get a good meal and they worry about if they don't. That's a kind of capital expense sometimes that the Board of Ed or the Board of Finance has picked up for us. If we needed pizza ovens or dishwashers or things like that.
Or the care of them.
Yeah. And that's the money situation.
Okay. Mr. Michelson.
Great. Enrollment figures have held it steady. A few things from the past month or so. One interesting training that I attended took place in Middletown, which I was on my lunch break as I was writing my principal's report, so it was fresh on my mind. But it was called Mental Health First Aid. And this is a new training that was legislated this year. It's a requirement that every school district sends their school district safety person, there's a fancier name for that, but I'm forgetting it right now, to attend this meeting. They were expecting between 30 and 40 people because there had been a set of three or four trainings, and there were five of us from around the city. Actually, a sixth person came, but she was in a different role. So the rest of their meetings are going to be a lot more crowded. So it was kind of nice to be able to get to be in a smaller group because it was the first training they've ever done in the state. What it was is essentially we went over different mental health issues, situations that young adults may face, what to do to identify those, what to do to help a student. Really, like you think of medical first aid, was a similar kind of thing. If I'm the principal and I'm there, what can I do to help that child until the big guns arrive? So until you know, the school psychologist, social worker, or another professional arrive. It was a two-day training. It was required that you went 2 days in a row. It was at the Connecticut Valley Hospital in Middletown. If you've never been there, it's an interesting place, almost spooky.
Pretty sad.
Yeah, there's one really big building. It looks like it was an institution at one time, all boarded up now. It's a very sad place to be. But the people from the state were great. They were wonderful. They did a really nice training, and I'm glad I got to participate in it. The school safety person from Newtown was one of the five that were there. And he had quite a few stories to tell about where he's from. So that was, and then it was really all the corners of the state were represented. So it was really an interesting group, and it was a good couple of days. Hopefully, I won't have to use it, but it was good training to get. I'm going to do my best to get through English Language Arts Common Core in about 10 minutes. So you could bear with me and maybe pass those for me. And I'm going to keep going. And then we can pass those as well. And then if we could kind of get our attention over to the screen. I'm not going to go through this entire PowerPoint, but I will go through it, some of you. My focus today is going to be on ELA, English Language Arts, which is essentially reading, writing, and it's also literacy and history, social studies, science. And well, we don't have the technical subjects here, but this covers K-12. So these are some key shifts in how we teach English language arts. And they're big changes. And they're, you know, they're things that have been a lot of work for our teachers, a lot of work for our students. But we can already see then they're going to be good changes, I think, once we get through the difficult ones. Major shift is away from a literature-focused standards to what we're calling a balance of literature and informational text. So rather than just focusing our reading on novels, on even classic literature, we're also going to be helping our kids with texts, which, as you know, is really important. When you get out to high school and you get on to college, if you go to tech school, it's really important that you can get through the texts that are teaching you the material that you need to learn for whatever profession you're going to head into. In writing, there's a strong emphasis on argument and informative explanatory writing. We used to call that persuasive writing, essentially, but now they're calling it argument, which I don't love the term, but we'll go with it. So using evidence to inform arguments. So again, the kind of writing that you're going to do in life, that you're going to do in college and in high school, are what we're going to be focusing on. Speaking and listening expectations. So formal and informal talk. So we're not just teaching kids to read and write, but also how they're going to express themselves verbally. Language arts standards put stress on general academics and domain-specific vocabulary, so we're trying to make sure that they know the words that they know, that they need, in science and social studies, in mathematics, wherever else. Also, reading, writing, and literacy across the curriculum. So we really, rather than just focusing on, we only teach reading and writing during reading and writing time, we're talking about how we're going to shift that to writing about science, writing about social studies, writing about math, writing about once you get to the upper grades, the high school age, writing about whatever other kind of classes that you're taking as well. Things that we focus on are CCR, College and Career Readiness Standards. So making sure, again, that we are grade-specific, building, getting our kids to where they need to be for life. K to 8, we focus grade by grade. So we have kindergarten standards, first grade standards, second grade, all the way through eighth grade. And then in high school, they start to bunch them together a little more, 9, 10, 11, 12 bands. And the focus, again, is reading, writing, speaking and listening, and language. Standards are embedded in grades K-5 in history, social studies, science. So we really are trying to teach things together rather than separating everything as we used to. Although sometimes we still do, we say it's science time, but we're also having to write. And certainly we're going to need it. Progressive development of reading. Students will gain more from what they read. So it's not just we read about a book, we talk about a book, and then we move on, but we're also looking to gain knowledge that we need in different areas. Again, like science and social studies. Grade level texts are appropriate and difficult. Difficulty is sophisticated, so making sure that what we give our kids are not too easy, not too hard, that we're giving them the right things to read when it comes to all of our subject areas here. There are exemplar texts in the Common Core, so they may give us examples of things that that the Common Core has decided are good materials, and we can use them or not. Text complexity is defined by qualitative measures, which are meaning the structure of the language. Can you read it? Quantitative readability, the other how complex is the text kind of things. And then the reader task, the background knowledge of the reader, the motivation, the interest, so bringing your outside world into what you're reading. Now this is an example of some of our standards. This is a grade 3, there's also a 7, and 11, and 12. And I gave to you the entire packet there. So you can look at that at your leisure, but there's a couple of examples that I will read to you today. You can look at them on your own. This is a format of how these are put together. So you can see this is what a fourth grade teacher might look at, and they can see where their fourth graders are expected to be. And they can also look back and they can see where they were expected to be in third grade and then what they're looking to prepare them for in fourth grade. So you can kind of have a look at the big picture of things.
And they really build one upon the next.
They really,
it's designed
really good. Yeah.
To, you know, it's just adding one more skill level at each.
At each. And like, if you look at an example, and that's what they're here. Determine the meaning in words and phrases as they are used in text. Distinguish literal from non-literal language. So you can kind of see what they're doing here. And then the next step up, determine the meaning of words and phrases as they are used in a text, including those that allude to significant characters. So here is both literal and non-literal. And here we're talking about characters, but relating to the same meaning of words. And then here, in fifth grade, the meaning of words focus in this line is how they're used, including figurative language, and we get into metaphors and similes. So you can see how it kind of builds as the student gets older. And if you were to look at all of the rows across, they do something similarly. In writing, we expect students to compose arguments and opinions, information, informative and explanatory pieces, and narrative texts. These are some of the kinds of writings that hopefully you'll see your kids doing, because they will be doing them here and then sometimes at home. Reason and evidence, so everything that they write, they need to back it up, just like you're expected to in your life now, or certainly when you're in school. Short projects in research, inquiry, so this is where we start to build those inquiry skills and the research. And they, you know, something we've been doing that's not really new to us, but we're perhaps looking at it in a little bit different way. Require students to incorporate technology as they create, refine, and collaborate on writing. So you may do a report on a topic in science, you may do a report on a book you read, and you may go down and you may put together a PowerPoint presentation. You may include charts and graphs with it. So whatever technology you may use. And then there are writing samples that we can look at to see if we're going where we want to go with our kids. Speaking, again, and listening. We're focusing on speaking and listening in a range of settings. Formal settings, informal, academic, small group, whole class. So there's some social aspects to this as well. Effective communication practices. So again, kind of back up to where the writing was. Make sure you back up your argument if you're having a debate or a discussion. That fits in there as well. Requiring interpretation and analysis of message as presented through oral, visual, or multimodal formats. So you may get something in writing, you may hear a tape, they may watch videos, and then how are they going to interact with those kind of materials. So those are things that you'll see coming, maybe more of a focus on that as the children get older in the high school years, but some things that we'll touch on here as well. Language, conventions for writing and speaking, certainly we cover that, grammar, vocabulary, acquisition through conversation, through reading, so building vocabulary, both in just general vocabulary and then related to topics of their study. History and social studies, so we're talking about knowledge of domain-specific vocabulary. So if we're talking about colonial era, then colonial era vocabulary will be focused and the kids will be expected to learn some of that. Analyzing and evaluating primary and secondary sources, so we may have kids to some degree here at the elementary school, but certainly more when they get older, looking at the Declaration of Independence, talking about it, what does it mean? A lot of focus on American documents, but there's also things from outside America. Synthesizing quantitative and technical information, including facts presented in maps, timelines, flowcharts, diagrams. So things that you may have thought of as social studies specific or math or science are more focused in here. As well. So how do you read a chart? How do you read a diagram? How do you put it into action? Think about working on a car, the number of diagrams and things that you need to look at for how that transmission gets put back together. You make a mistake, you put a thing in the wrong place because you couldn't read a diagram, your car's not going to go anywhere. So those are important skills to have. Writing standards for history and social studies, writing arguments, so it goes right back to what we were writing, what we were talking about, using data, using evidence, and domain-specific vocabulary. So that vocabulary that they learned, then when they write about it, they have to show that they learned it. I don't know if that was 10 minutes. It went really fast. But don't look at that yet. What I handed out to you were a couple of things. One is your Common Core State Standards English Language Arts. This is something that you really can take some time to look at if you find it interesting or informative. It looks like the backs are upside down. That'll make it interesting for you to read. This is K-5 focus at the beginning, and then you'll see the 6, 8, and 9, 10 high school stuff near the end. And again, you're not going to get through all of this tonight while we're sitting here meeting, but feel free to take a look at it. If you have any questions, to let me know. The next sheet was one that is closely tied to what we're talking about today. This is one that was given to me at a meeting that I went to with the state of Connecticut, and I went and actually found that it's on the Common Core website. And what this is I would guess as board members, that probably along the way somewhere you've been asked the question, what do you think of Common Core? There's some myths here that they tried to answer on this form, and I thought that it might be a helpful thing for you to have if one of your constituents is asking you what you think of the Common Core. Because there's a lot of misinformation out in the world, and I won't read through this, but this is a document that you can take with you to have if you start to get those phone calls. If you have any questions about that, please feel free to ask. Some of the important ones are that number two there, standards are not internationally benchmarked, is one of the rumors that are out there, and they most certainly are. You'll hear once in a while that things like second graders are asked to read the Grapes of Wrath, and that's just not the case. Ninth and tenth graders are asked to read the Grapes of Wrath, but we don't ask our second graders to do that. Rachel said no. The other Rachel. Things like English teachers will be asked to teach science and social studies reading material. Not exactly true, but it is here, so it always happened though. No teachers were involved in writing the standards. They most certainly were. Not any of ours, but teachers from around the country. And you can, again, you can look at that at your leisure and let me know if you had any questions about it.
It's just interesting to me, just a comment, maybe I lost track of the thing here. When you were whizzing through this book.
Yeah, sorry.
I don't mean that. No, because I'll have to absorb it and read it down the road. But the conventions for writing and speaking, and you alluded to the fact that it includes grammar.
Yes.
Boy, I didn't see grammar mentioned any place.
The word grammar was not in that particular document, but you will see it in here.
There's lots of it in here.
In fact, some of our...
There's a convention section.
Because English grammar is certainly something...
Our teachers have SLOs, which are their student learning objectives,
okay.
And they each have to have two academic ones. And I have one, I've asked them to do one on writing this year and one on math. And several teachers are focusing on punctuation skills or grammar skills. Yeah, so that is something that
kind
is
of critical.
It's
all you have
absolutely
to do is
critical. And,
listen to radio and television, and no one can speak correctly.
Well, forget radio and television. If you want a job and you write a cover letter that's not written well, you're not even going to get an interview. Anne, would you want to talk about the Arab folk music presentation? I wasn't there.
Oh, yeah. let's see. At the beginning of the month, we had a cultural event. Kareem Nagy.
It was last week.
Was it last week?
Yeah.
And he was just great. He did a presentation on Arabic culture, essentially. And I just loved him. I thought he was a perfect mix of teacher, performer, musician. I thought he was great. He spoke well to the students. He talked about things that I thought were pretty interesting and different to them. He showed them how to write some words in Arabic. He showed what countries speak Arabic languages, and they paid attention the whole time, rapt attention. Everybody paid attention. It was great. And they had a good time. They got up and they danced. He performed with several different instruments and described them and interacted with the kids. It was really, I loved it. I thought it was great. I was also very proud of the fact that I feel like it's one of the most kind of different things that we've done, and I love the idea that it shows another side of Arabic culture. We get very used to seeing certain kinds of images of
diversity.
Yeah, of Middle Eastern culture on the news, and this shows a different side, a very large part of that culture. So that's great. It was wonderful. I really enjoyed it. I think the kids did too. So.
Yeah. All the reports I've got were positive.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah, everybody.
That's good. That's what we like to hear.
His drawings are in my office, so I got to see them.
Yeah, that's good. Oh, cool.
His maps and his Arabic writing.
You know, I took a couple of videos during his presentation, and if at some point, even on the website as it is now,
password. You can go right up.
Maybe they could be linked there.
I'd
love to share them because they're just.
That'd be great. So okay with that?
I didn't ask him, but I will.
Great.
I mean, he has on his website. He has a lot of videos,
okay.
So I don't know if he'd want to be somehow referenced or linked or something like that. But I will ask him. About.
Great, sounds good. Parent-teacher conferences is my last item, which I'm guessing some of you have received some feedback on over the last couple of weeks.
We did.
We don't have parent-teacher conferences in place again until March, but something that I would like you to think about is that we could work together to find a way that we could extend the time of our conferences. Given the new teacher's contract, it allowed for 3 hours of conference time. And really, we need about twice that in order to get a good-sized conference in there, a 15 or 20-minute conference. We were, when I took the time, I divided it by our largest class. It gave us 8 minutes with a one-minute passing time. And, of course, teachers are willing to meet with parents that needed some extra time at a different, again, or previously, and they do that anyways. But it would be nice if we could maybe have a half day at conference time, just one, perhaps do an afternoon set of conferences and then do an evening the next day or vice versa, depending on how it worked. But we have some time, I believe, to think about that. And
work on it.
And work on it, and perhaps there's some other ideas and ways to make that happen. But I would
yeah,
like
I think
to
we need to give that some serious thought because that was not acceptable.
It was not enough time. But if there's other suggestions on how to make it happen, I'd certainly be open to hearing them, bringing them back to the teachers.
Mm-hmm. And can I make one point too, that I know you were trying to consolidate times for mm-hmm. parents, but when you have multiple children and they're back to back, there was no time to get from one to the other, and we got behind because
right.
of the first
and
teacher, and we almost
you understand why the tradition was to do that so that you wouldn't have to hang around for
and
that
I
time in there.
I appreciate that.
And that was the original yeah. thought.
An extra 8 minutes with this.
Wouldn't have been such a big
totally
deal.
Messed up my evening. So.
Hopefully we'll find a way to make that work better.
Okay.
I think once I hope both parties recognize that was a disaster.
I know. It didn't help.
Seemed like a good idea at the time, right?
Yeah.
There were negotiations that we...
About 3 o'clock in the morning, probably. Some
probably.
Of us weren't as sharp as we should have been.
Well, speaking from my perspective, the month of November is kind of a crazy month, but there used to be Veterans Day. That was the
right.
day. And then you ran into the Thanksgiving holiday. And it was always the traditional parent conferences. And for the last 3 years, probably, there was an ice storm, a snowstorm, or something where the kids were just,
right.
you know, just parents were saying, you know, when is it that they go to school? So one of the things that that the board was concerned about as we entered into negotiations was to see if we could do something with all of this release time, you know, that the teacher, that we wouldn't be sending the kids home at 1 o'clock of what seemed like every other day because of the 90-minute delay or weather delay or parent conferences or staff development or whatever. So the board entered into negotiation thinking that it would be good if we didn't have release time so parents wouldn't have to be concerned about having the kids being sent home all the time, particularly, like I said, around holidays and weather and everything else. And we traditionally had 2 days of release time in the contract, and through negotiation, we said, well, let's do away with the release time. How much time do you think we would need? So there was 1 day put in, and for 3 hours, let's see how that works out. Didn't work out too good. So we're back to the drawing board or not, so I'm not quite sure. Board, any change now obviously would be a change to contract. We're looking at the calendar for next year tonight. There are no release days in that calendar either, so it'll all be part of the sausage making as we begin to deal with that. But 8 minutes didn't do it, didn't cut it.
What's involved with changing the contract if you decide to make a half day?
Well, I think if it's to provide the teachers with more time, it's not an issue. It's, you know, yeah. But that's a question.
That would be time the teachers would have to be here anyway, so
yeah.
It would be a shift from, rather than the student time, it would be conference time. So I don't think that would be too difficult.
There might be, obviously we'll sit down with them and see what we can work out, but we'll be coming back to the board with some suggestions.
The last item was not on my report, but I handed out to you a copy of our emergency procedure flowchart, which I would like to hang into classrooms tomorrow. This would be a quick guide. It would be, they're laminated with a class list on the back, hole punched and hanging on a hook right by the door. So if we, if somebody gets on the PA system or if the fire alarm goes off, this is something that the teacher, if you're a sub or if you're the regular classroom teacher, you can grab it and you can see step by step what do we need to do in this this particular case. So for example, if I were to get on the PA and say, we need to seek refuge, please grab your flow chart and follow the steps. Teachers would give students, quiet them, give them directions, move them to a designated safe area in the room, away from glass and doors. Kids wouldn't be allowed to go to the bathroom during that time. Nobody can leave the safe area, which in this room would probably be maybe over there, would be the best spot in that room, but each room would be different. Teacher would take attendance and simply make note of any missing or extra students. No radios or televisions would be played in the room, and they would remain in that safe area until directed. During that time, if it became an extended amount of time, what would happen is we would actually have a bucket toilet that we would use in the case of a real emergency with a tarp that could hang around it. Wouldn't be pretty, but this would be not during a drill, certainly this would be during the real thing only. And then we would have a survival pack with water and some food if needed, flashlights, that kind of thing in there in case they were needed. And then you can, you know, I won't go through this whole flow chart, but you can see what all of the steps are. Avoid area is the other one that might seem a little weird. The kind of thing that might make that happen would be a medical emergency or some kind of mental health emergency, something like that, in an area that we wanted to keep everybody away from. So everything else in the rest of the building would go on as normal except that one area. The other thing that will be coming with this will be a drill. My plans are to do a drill, probably protect in place or seek refuge drill, sometime January or February. The first step would be to pick a date, then it would be to notify parents so they would all get notification what would happen, the day it's going to happen. This one wouldn't be a surprise, all the kids would know. Hopefully it would be a very quick drill and keep them in place in 2, 3, maybe 5 minutes. And then we would move on with our day. The evacuation drill, I believe Mr. Cutter brought it to this board already. We need to do, tell me the language again, Mr. Cutter.
It's a full response drill.
Full response drill, that's right. And I spoke with some other principals in other schools that have done them already, spoke to our state trooper, and this full response drill would be we would find a place where if we were needed to evacuate where we might want to bring them, the police would actually come, perhaps the fire department would come, block the road for us, and we would be able to walk down to Sally's porch and have a lemonade and then walk on back. So those would be our plans, but that would be obviously pre-planned. Parents would know about that in advance. State police and the fire department would join us and assist, so it would help them as well. So take a look at those. I'm viewing this as a document that we want to keep in place for a little while before we make changes, but I'm viewing it as fluid. So if we try these drills and we see that anything doesn't work, we'll go back, we'll make changes, adjust them as needed. But I can tell you that Caroline knows there was a lot of time put into making this what it is here, a lot of changes.
Official approval?
Don't approve it tonight. Why don't you just receive it, think about it, okay. And we'll talk about it. At some point we'll need to accept it, if not vote it. Because if we do any one of these, other than the fire drill, you know, I'm sure you're going to hear from parents as to what's
right.
what's going on. You know,
I assure you, there will not be one that happens before our a drill anyway. That happens before this RSV.
Obviously, the state's requiring 3 full response drills, and we're still plus the fire drills, which go on and on. So. There's just a whole lot of attention on school safety, which of course is important. But I forgot to mention to Michael that costs money too.
It's 3 full response drills before the end of the school year.
When I saw full response, I was thinking evacuation where the school buses would come, and we go through that whole scene. seems to be a little softer than that now. Might, a seek refuge might be considered a full response, something other than a fire drill.
My thought is every month we do a fire drill, and then three times throughout the year we'll do a drill on one of the other.
Yeah, Sergeant Yanko was at our last safety meeting, and he said that Colbrook had already done a full evacuation drill, Salisbury, and a couple of the other schools.
Yeah.
Colbrook left their school and walked down.
He walked to town hall about a quarter.
They walked to town, the whole school.
They closed all the roads for that time.
But look it over. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of notoriety with Newtown's anniversary here about school safety. And there's also talk of the state of Connecticut coming out with some kind of a template that they lay on every school district that says, this is what you need to do. So that's where it is now. Right now, we do need to have a school safety team, and we do need to have a mental health teacher on the committee. So our school psychologist said that she would serve on that. So that's the weak link in this whole thing, is about that, that mental health part of it.
I think the legislation is trying to.
But I think school safety is going to be on the agenda probably from now until June, so it's not going to go away.
Before we get to the standing committees, I just had Kathy reproduce for me, and I just because you don't have enough to read and digest for this meeting, I have an article just in the Wall Street Journal recently, and I just thought it was something this board. Should look at, or anyone in the audience that wants to look at it, regarding verbal testing. Thank you, Donna.
Moving right along.
Moving right along before Carolyn falls asleep. I'm just teasing you, Carol. It's been quite a hectic day. First standing committee is personnel and personnel negotiations. Donna, do you just want to say, I know we have to go to an executive session regarding negotiations, but.
We're in the middle of custodial negotiations at present.
Okay, Donna, you're on for transportation.
I don't believe there's anything on our transportation.
No, probably the only thing, and I don't know if I mentioned it at the past meeting, with the Colbrook regional study going on, I did provide Billy Whalen with the bus list from Colbrook as well as the Norfolk bus list so that he can review it and decide what he would like to do about it if he were the contractor for the new district, if and when it occurs. So I haven't heard back from Billy yet on that.
And by the way, regarding committees, which are assigned by the chair, for the new people, I would love to hear if you have a particular interest in a particular committee. Doesn't mean everyone will get it, or if you're currently working on a committee you want to stay on, or whatever, it would give me help as to what.
Could you list the committees?
They're in the back of your.
They're on the back of the sheet. Personnel, transportation, building. We've got a slew of them in. Yeah. And you're more than welcome to serve.
Show us a big hole in.
Right. You're more than welcome to serve on more than one.
The standing committees are, you know, by policy are the top four.
Yes.
And then there's.
But we have others.
Yeah. The ad hocs are where the action is usually.
Buildings and grounds. Joe, anything?
Yes. You do.
I do. Walk over there.
Pull the sign.
Ready?
This is at one of our meetings, I don't know if it was the October meeting or November meeting, the board set aside kind of a budget to, as we look forward to the.
I don't like it's a new one.
I know it's a new one.
This, This is Mr. Michelson. This would show east and west on 44. And this is the community board that would be attached underneath so that you can put down PTO meeting, blah, 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 blah.
And the material is?
Oh, no.
Wood.
That's on the inside of the stone wall, the outside of the stone wall.
Wood.
Inside.
Yeah, that's why it's got to get up. The stone wall is here. Yeah, that's state, everything in front of the wall is state property. So that's why we need to put it on standards. This is locked plastic or?
The letters are plastic, but the sign is wood.
Yeah, but you can lift this up and change all the letters and then put it down locked.
It's not permanent, that bottom part has to, it comes on and off.
And how do you affix the letters? Are they in like little slots?
I think he's going to close it so it locks.
I think they slide in, but they're going to be
secure that something can't be.
The hotel school part is wood. The top part.
Top is wood.
Yes.
What are the dimensions of it?
The top part.
Glad you brought that up.
Scale is very important.
The town, when it gets to the town and signs, it's tricky.
Yeah, there is a sign.
Before we asked for anything, we got the ordinance, the town ordinance from planning and zoning or whoever does those kinds of things for the town. We took those and we gave them to Mr. Gee, the sign maker. So he knew. Plus he does this all over the state, so he's pretty sensitive to that stuff. So anyway, what do you think of the Eagle, Sally?
I'm not crazy, but it's better. An improvement.
It's
sweet for Dodo versus.
That's the gentle eagle. It's better than the eagle on the gym floor. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah. I like that.
You like that eagle?
I want real materials, as long as it's wood.
I'm sorry, did you say what the dimensions were? Or you just said that they're within standards?
They're the maximum for what the town would hold up. Was this four?
Four by scale and proportion is very important.
No, 3 by 6, or 20 something square.
Yeah, we made it bigger by hanging the other part out.
I'll find my email, because it's something.
We went to the maximum of the town ordinance anyway.
I'm 5'9".
So I have a question.
Yes.
Suppose that we do combine with Colebrook, or the Colebrook kids are coming here.
We already have a sign, they gotta keep the name.
Oh, okay, then.
So I don't want to put all the money into the sign school, and then have to change it.
Yeah.
And then you feel that it was,
Or it'd be another reason not to change it.
There would be a region number attached to the school.
I'm not saying a region, I'm just saying the Colebrook kids are coming here. If the Colebrook kids are coming here, then would the name stay the same? And you said they already agreed, so that's it.
They did agree.
2 by 6.
2 by 6. So it's only it's 2 feet high.
Six feet across.
It's 6 feet.
It's 12.
It's 6 feet across?
Yes.
No,
it's 6 feet. Whatever it is, Sally, we can't have it more than 2 by 6 feet.
Must be 6 feet tall.
The hole must be 6 feet tall.
For the actual sign.
So the hole, as related to that piece, it's the board itself that we cannot have any larger.
Then 2 feet wide or 6 feet wide?
2 feet by 6 feet, which is 12 square feet. It cannot be any more than 12 square feet.
So it could be 3 by 4.
Yes, and maybe that's what he
did. More feet.
Oh, yeah, 3 by 4. Because it wouldn't be 6 feet wide.
How big do you think that board is?
Well, that's probably about 10.
The one behind Rachel, the whiteboard, is probably more realistic.
That's 36 by probably 60.
That's about 5 feet.
That's 5 feet, I would say.
So 3 by 5.
Or, I mean, I'm sorry, 4 by 5.
With the ceiling tiles.
I would say it's 5 feet wide.
The ceiling tiles are 2 by 4.
Scale is very important when you look at
But yeah, that's hard when you're doing something like this to imagine.
He didn't give me the scales when he sent it to me today, especially, but I mean,
well, that's what we need to know.
He knows the restrictions, what we have to follow according to.
Well, I think we need to know the dimensions and how it.
I think the person really is there to show scale.
Yeah.
Okay, we got the dimensions for next week.
Okay.
But he does great work, so it'll be done.
Jill, I'm assuming there's nothing on policy, I'm not trying to.
No, we need to do the.
We have to do a hold on it.
Oh, yeah, we're doing a hold on that?
Yeah, and the reason we're holding, if you're wondering what this is, the 5114, this is the marijuana and the.
Oh, right, yeah.
And the little knife.
Yes, the little knife.
The little knife.
Oh, right, yes.
As opposed to a dagger, but, yeah, and we were supposed to check with Conan on that, and that didn't happen.
Okay, well, we'll go on then.
Yeah, so that's a hold.
Shared services, that is Carolyn.
Yeah, you have October minutes, because we didn't meet in November, but there wasn't anything.
Nothing particular?
Yeah. I don't know why we didn't meet in November, I called it off at the last minute, so.
All right.
Education connection? I know that's going to be a committee appointment that everyone's going to want to jump all over, so.
There's nothing, we got something from them, just what services are available for the district. And for new members, Ed Connection has a monthly meeting for all of the districts that participate and serve on the board of directors, so they have a board of directors of 2,050 people, it seems, you know, they have a big old board of directors and they meet once a month and.
Where do they meet?
They meet at Ed Connection and.
In Litchfield.
And.
And for a new member, it's great to go for a meeting or two, but.
We've been having a rotating member at 10.
I think it's the fourth, is it the fourth Thursday?
Yeah.
Third.
We'll get a schedule.
Thursday.
We'll get the.
First Thursday of the month.
We'll get their schedule. We'll get their schedule.
Right.
They have a dinner meeting.
And they provide dinner.
They provide dinner and then they go to their meeting. We'll get a schedule for next meeting.
PTO, Jill, Paul?
Oh, the new bylaws.
The new bylaws.
Not that you have anything to say about it, but.
But you put them in here.
I put them in there, only that you would be aware of it in light of some of the ongoing notoriety that the PTO got back a few months ago. Much to the credit of the leadership of the hotel PTO, they got together and they came up with some bylaws and set down some rules and regulations as to how they intend to do their business. And it's all good. Anything else anybody want to say about it?
The PTO has the holiday fair happening this month.
All right.
That's always a very popular event, very popular with the students. Mm-hmm. And so Lisa is working very hard and others to help her put that on. We have some additional fundraiser ideas.
We still have more donations for the holiday fair, by the way, if there's parents listening on.
That's right, eight to 10.
Per family, we're looking for?
We ask for per family, more if you'd like. This is not a fundraiser that the PTO does. This is a service that they provide. And it's a really nice way for the kids to be able to shop in a very reasonable place and to get things that they feel is good for their family. And it's really very sweet. I really think it is. The kids
when
are
is that
very,
again?
Very proud of
next
it.
Week.
And they,
next week?
They do it on
Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, I believe?
Yeah, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Yeah. Gonna have closing golf ball from there.
Yeah, so you see the holiday fair at elementary school.
Sure,
how often do you see them? We don't have a holiday fair, we know that.
So that's a little golf balls.
Yeah.
Remind me of the future.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Some golf balls.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Is the president of the PTO continuing in her role? with her new responsibilities?
Yes, she will be continuing.
Two hats? You're gonna wear two hats as a...
Oh, I'm the vice president.
Oh, who's the president?
Lisa.
Oh, Lisa Pizzano, oh, okay, I thought, forget, I thought that you were the president. How could I ever forget Lisa, don't tell her.
Okay, next, we have curriculum.
We got K.
Okay, sorry, I skipped K.
As a new board member, Ann, you might be getting all kinds of mail from K regarding orientations for new board members. They're all optional on you and what your time is, and, but if you care to attend, and there's any kind of registration fee, you know, work it out with Janet, we'll get you registered. Get you to those workshops.
Yeah, new board members.
Yes, new board members are encouraged to go, and I think you will find it worthwhile.
Yeah.
What sorts of things do they, knowledge do they impart?
Your role on the board.
Your role, all kinds of statutes of how things operate. They deal with all kinds of committees, all kinds of things. They usually have a very good commencement speaker.
State and federal guidelines regarding what you can do.
Actually, we're too late.
What?
December 10th.
December 10th is too late? Yeah.
It was yesterday.
Oh, I'm sorry. But next time, so...
But if you get stuff in the mail...
There'll be another one.
Yeah.
We can find out if there's anything that they might have distributed.
K is your lobby in Hartford, and Region 1 is, we're in Region 1 when it comes to K. So, and that includes most everybody in the northwest corner, including Winstead and Torrington, I think. So, there might be regional meetings as well. Generally, they use our regional high school for those breakfast meetings. They invite selectmen, board of finance members. They try to make nicey-nice about the money, but... But anyway, I just wanted to mention that. Okay, we belong to CAVE, so if you get stuff about CAVE, remember.
And you will be getting lots, I'm sure.
Okay.
Curriculum? We have science kits there.
Yeah, let me, in light of our guest this evening talking about next year's budget, the school administration has already begun putting together budget to present to you at the second meeting in January. And science kits were on last year's list, Christmas list, and I put it here as a reminder to me to say to you all, if you have ideas as to what you would like to see regarding the school next year, programs, materials, whatever, you need to get it to Peter or to myself so that I can begin to include it in the budget.
Doesn't mean we'll get it.
Not that you'll get it, obviously, but anyway, it's budget time. The science kits were talked about last year.
Approximately 10,000, were they?
Yeah, so we were gonna buy, the idea was we were gonna buy science kits and the teachers would use the science kits and we had a science room and everything would be wonderful. Since then, it seems to me, Madam Chairman, that the shift that I'm hearing in the regional discussion is that we not only need kits, but we need a teacher. Like Mr. Wizard, a science teacher. The discussion at the regional meeting is, well, if we have a science room, then you put the teacher in there and the kids rotate in and out of the room, as opposed to giving the kids to the teachers and saying we're going to spend more time on science this year than we did in the past, or you put the science on kids on a cart and the science teacher goes from room to room at certain times through scheduling or whatever. But that's just science. I'm also hearing about math. Mm-hmm. Math and science kind of go together. And that we should be doing more with our students in math. Long and short of all of this, just to wrap it up, is that we're getting into the budget season. The board traditionally has taken time to talk about the budget, what you would like to see, what's not happening that you think would happen. All day K was part of that discussion a few years back. We've got to that. We've talked about expanding pre-K in the past. We want to do that. Administratively, I will be working with Peter and staff members regarding some of the things that we would like to see or that we would like to at least bring forward to the board for proposals. But it's easier for us to include it in the budget than to come with the budget and say, well, you know, can we do this or can we do that? So the budget, the first draft of the budget you'll receive maybe the end of January. There's a conflict, incidentally, with the with our meeting date, with the regional meeting date. So but we can work that out.
No,
but,
we can work that
but,
out.
But as you sit there, all board members, new and veterans, it's budget time. If you're thinking about things for the school, now's the time to talk about them at the board member, try to gain other board member support for your idea or whatever. Which brings me to technology, because one of the things that we talked about a few weeks back when Michelle was here was getting rid of the desktops and going to tablets and iPads. Peter's going to be working with our librarian technology teacher, Mrs. Snyder, to put together a proposal on that. Well, if we did it, how much is it going to cost? What happens to the other machines? Why are we doing it? What's the rationale? That kind of thing. So we'll be trying to answer those questions to the board as well.
Which also there's been discussion how that may impact the science kids.
I mean,
it's all related, you know, intertwined and related. Right.
One thing about technology is that it can get to any place you want to go.
For all members, curriculum and technology are very important.
Mm-hmm.
Think about those committees when you're thinking about what you like to look at. Community relations.
I don't have nothing.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
That's fine.
Health and wellness. You can see we have a few holes here.
That was Michelle's
name. Michelle was very instrumental in curriculum, technology, and health and wellness. So,
and policy.
Those are big shoes to fill. Okay, we have the Colbrook Study Committee.
Take just a minute. In your packet, you have
handout number 7.
Yeah, handout number 7. There are at least, I have 4, but I think you only have 3. The fourth one I think Jill has is on facilities. Yeah. The important one is the one that's stamped handout number 7. Mm-hmm. That's the general committee. Do you have that one? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's the general committee. That wasn't a subcommittee. This is Jonathan Costa with everybody.
Full appointed committee.
Yeah. This is
from Norfolk and Hope.
All right. This is what they came up with. Because of the subcommittees were saying to the general committee, you know, we really need to know what the timeline is for this, because it's going to make a difference. So this is the timeline that the general committee came up with. All the subcommittees would complete their reports by April, and they would submit them to the full committee. The full committee would then approve those subcommittee reports or amend them and then approve them. But the subcommittees are going to be done by April. Full committee will vote on them in April. The full committee then would go to a town hearing to share all of these subcommittee reports, which I'm going to call the report. When all the subcommittees finish their work, it all comes together, they're going to go to the town hearing in May. Now, what else happens in May in this town? Budget. All right, full committee reacts to the town hearing. You go to a hearing, people say, this is the best plan I heard, this is the worst plan I heard, whatever. The full committee then goes back in May and reacts to the town hearing input. Assuming it's positive, they would vote then to submit the plan to the State Board of Education. That would be May of this year, of the coming year, 5 months from now. The plan would be submitted to the State Board of Ed in June. The State Board has 30 days by law to respond to the proposal. Assuming the state approves it, they would send it back to the full committee by August, and the town would have 45 to 90 days by law to vote on a referendum from the date that the state approved it. Now I'm saying August, might be earlier or later. So
to vote on whether to have a referendum?
No, no. You would take the plan,
to vote on
that full plan that the state approved, said you guys up there did a really good job with this, we're approving it.
To regionalize Norfolk and Colton.
It would come back to the full committee. Norfolk would call for a referendum. Colebrook would call for a referendum. As best we know, both towns would then have to approve. If one voted up or down, it would fail. The town referendum was talked about in November. Now, I think the governor's race is in November of the coming year, so I think it's tied around a statewide fall election.
But it's one referendum, right?
The referendum in both would be both towns.
And is that on the same day? Each town has a referendum, Norfolk would have it on
Day 10. If it's tied into the gubernatorial fall election date, it would be on that ballot, November ballot. That's talked about. This is still, the time.
This is a very ambitious.
Now, yes. If both towns approve it, you would have between November of 2014 and August of 2015 to do the planning, and the students would arrive at their new school in September of 2015. And everybody talked that this is really ambitious, you're kidding me. They felt it to be doable. Now, I'm not saying I felt it was going to be doable. The full committee said it was doable.
And the idea is to do it super fast because it would save us money faster. Is that?
No, I didn't hear that.
Why? I would say that's the reason to do it.
I didn't.
Maybe it wasn't talked about.
They didn't get into that. And one of the other things, when they make this comparative of budgets between Norfolk and Colebrook that Mike kind of referenced tonight, they're going to use our chart of accounts in breaking out two budgets. There'll be more to follow on that. One of the things that the full committee talked about was a rotating schedule of special teachers, where art, music, phys ed, science, if there's going to be, math, if there's going to be, would somehow rotate, as opposed to saying every Wednesday afternoon is going to be music. We're going to have PE on Tuesday, Thursday. This week you may have to, one of the schedules has, you might have phys ed this week, Tuesday, Thursday, but at some other time, it might be Monday, Wednesday.
But didn't we go back to say that the
That hasn't been nailed down.
Yeah.
Everybody seems to think that a static schedule, or one that doesn't change, would be a lot easier for the whole world. But that's still not tacked down. Although in my meeting with the budget subcommittee chair, Mr. Millard, this week, he did say, I think it would make more sense if it was stationary than static.
Can't share with other schools.
Okay, that's the big committee, okay? So now you know why it's important to keep reading these meetings. Now, I have, my next meeting was November 25th. You don't have this. This is on facilities. Do you mind if I go through this with you?
No, George, go ahead.
Go ahead, all right. The facility subcommittee, which is made up of Jill Hall, Bill Bernitsky, myself, I have attached myself to that committee, Hope Cafaro, Tom McKeon, Sherry Gray, and Mike Lazaro, or Grazzo, Grazzo, correct. Is it Lazaro? Okay. They met on the 25th at 6:30. Why did we meet? We met with two architects. And the architects were here to tell us some of the ideas that they had about what we should do to the school building in order, if it ever became a joint committee, I mean a joint school. Quisenberry Associates came and made a wonderful presentation, presented the committee with some wonderful ideas, and talked about state compliance and filing with the State Facilities Bureau, and went on and on. I think he, quite frankly, overwhelmed the subcommittee. Second architect, Mr. James Lawler, who is semi-retired architect, presented himself more as a consultant, was willing to work with the subcommittee to look at what we have, how many kids are we talking about, how much room are we going to need, short-term plan versus long-term plan. The committee liked him. He's going to be serving as a consultant to the subcommittee. The committee the full committee had approved $5,000 to engage the services of an architect. So Mr. Lawler will be working with that subcommittee. And the first task is to look at the enrollment and to try to find room in the building for those kids if they were to come, and who's left out in the hallway. So that's an interesting committee.
May I just add something to that? Also, as part of the discussion, was if you go back and look in the original reporting of Jonathan Costa about the statistics of the enrollments over the next few years, that there's, if they're true, a remarkable drop-off. So the question is, would it make sense to look at making all these changes, some of them quite dramatic, and then have it fall way off in a very short span of time? Would it not be better to wait? It's only a matter of 12 or 18 months that happens before we spend all the money. Something else for consideration. There's always two sides to a pancake to look at when you're looking at making those kinds of changes.
Speaking of pancakes, the fiscal subcommittee met. That is made up of Mr. Chittum, Mr. Counter, Mr. Crone, Ms. Dyer, Ms. Millar, and Mr. Vosper. They met on December 3rd, and they talked about spreadsheets and they're money people. So anyway, the long and the short that came out of that meeting is that Mr. Millar would meet with myself and Mr. Chittum, Superintendent Chittum and Colbert. And he did meet with me yesterday on the snow day. We met, we had plenty of time to talk about, and Janet had provided all of our teachers, all of our budget broken out. So he can play the game of putting them together. And then once he puts them together, I think the plan is, and I'm not sure, but I think the plan is for the fiscal subcommittee to say to the superintendent, well, how many teachers are you going to need to do this? And we're going to say 14. How many of this? How many of that? And he's going to come up with a budget that will meet the needs of Colebrook and Norfolk together in this building. And then they're going to expand it out into the future and say, this is how much it's going to cost 5 years from today. This is how much it costs now. And try to build it out. Any questions on that? I think that's what's going to happen. And the
are
budget.
Happy of that for all of us?
Yeah. Well, that one's in your file. And then there was a Tuesday, the Norfolk Corvus budget. The budget subcommittee met on the 3rd. Mr. Millar prepared a document. It's intended to delineate the line item budgets and blah, blah, blah. So pretty much what I just said. He's still working to put that together. I think the next time the budget committee meets, he'll probably have what is being referred to as a pro forma budget, which would be Colebrook and Norfolk together and what we're spending. Now, he's going to, I think, at some point run into the wall because our benefits are better than their benefits for our people. Mm-hmm. But we'll let him work that out.
And particularly our parents probably and secretaries and so forth.
Yeah, we have paid holidays and paid a decent wage, and you're entitled to health benefits, and if you don't take them. But anyway, it'll all get washed out. So that's what's going on. So I'm going to try to keep you guys informed through these subcommittees because you can't attend them all. But you're going to be asked questions out there. Reporters don't attend the meeting, so it's hard to get the information out. So this is the best way that I think we could do it. Because this is the most important decision the town's made in 100 years. People ought to know what's going on. That's what I kind of figured. This is what's going on.
100 years, a little less.
Yeah. So, Jill, do you know?
About 60.
Do you know the meeting dates? I think our next meeting
is the 18th.
The full committee,
I believe, is the 18th.
12/18.
At 6:30 in Colebrook. At the Colebrook School. Let me check.
Governance is meeting tomorrow night. Tomorrow night. Sally's subcommittee is meeting tomorrow night on governance. Like, who's in charge?
What time is that meeting, Sally?
6:30.
Here?
Mm-hmm.
In this room.
Okay.
And who do you think is on your committee? You and Jeannie Jones and?
Our advisor.
Oh, you're on governance.
Sarah.
All right.
Mike Skynyrs is on, Julie Schomburg is on.
Oh, what a meeting.
Larry Hannafin is on.
What a meeting.
We're going to have lots of fun.
That's tomorrow night?
No egg throwing or anything.
The 12th. So you're meeting on the 12th.
At 6:30. Would you like to come, George?
No. I'm going Christmas shopping. I'm going to be here Monday night at 6:30 with facilities.
Yes. I really do think we could have.
And then there's, I'll be back again on Wednesday night, the 18th. So this is the timeline that the general committee came up with. All the subcommittees would complete their reports by April. And they would submit them to the full committee. The full committee would then approve those subcommittee reports or amend them and then approve them. But the subcommittees are going to be done by April. Full committee will vote on them in April. The full committee then would go to a town hearing to share all of these subcommittee reports, which I'm going to call the report. Mm-hmm. When all the subcommittees finish their work, it all comes together, they're going to go to the town hearing in May. Now what else happens in May in this town? Budget. All right, full committee reacts to the town hearing. You go to a hearing, people say, this is the best plan I heard, this is the worst plan I heard, whatever. The full committee then goes back in May and reacts to the town hearing input. Assuming it's positive, they would vote then to submit the plan to the State Board of Education. That would be May of this year, of the coming year, 5 months from now. The plan would be submitted to the State Board of Ed in June. The State Board has 30 days by law to respond to the proposal. Assuming the state approves it, they would send it back to the full committee by August, and the town would have 45 to 90 days by law to vote on a referendum from the date that the state approved it. Now I'm saying August, might be earlier or later. So
to vote on whether to have a referendum?
No. You would take the plan, that full plan that the state approved, said you guys up there did a really good job at this, we're approving it.
To regionalize Norfolk and Colton.
It would come back to the full committee. Norfolk would call for a referendum. Colebrook would call for a referendum. As best we know, both towns would then have to approve. If one voted up or down, it would fail. The town referendum was talked about in November. Now, I think the governor's race is in November of the coming year, so I think it's tied around a statewide fall election.
But it's one referendum, right? The
referendum in both would be both towns.
And is that on the same day? Each town has a referendum,
Norfolk
would have it on,
yeah,
say,
the 10th.
And
if it's tied into the gubernatorial fall election date, it would be on that ballot. November ballot. That's talked about. This is still, the timeline.
This is a very ambitious.
Now, yes. If both towns approve it, you would have between November of 2014 and August of 2015 to do the planning, and the students would arrive at their new school in September of 2015. And everybody talked that this is really ambitious, you're kidding me. They felt it to be doable. Now, I'm not saying I felt it was to be doable, but the full committee said it was doable.
And the idea is to do it super fast because it would save us money faster. I didn't hear that.
Why? I would say that's
the reason to do it.
Maybe it wasn't talked about.
They didn't get into that. And one of the other things, when they make this comparative of budgets between Norfolk and Colebrook that Mike kind of referenced tonight, they're going to use our chart of accounts in breaking out two budgets. There'll be more to follow on that. One of the things that the full committee talked about was a rotating schedule of special teachers, where art, music, phys ed, science, if there's going to be, math, if there's going to be, would somehow rotate, as opposed to saying every Wednesday afternoon is going to be music. We're going to have PE on Tuesday, Thursday. This week you may have, one of the schedules has, you might have phys ed this week, Tuesday, Thursday, but at some other time it might be Monday, Wednesday.
But didn't we go back to say that hasn't been nailed down. Yeah.
Everybody seems to think that a static schedule, or one that doesn't change, would be a lot easier for the whole world.
But
it didn't. That's still not tacked down. Uh-huh. Although in my meeting with the budget subcommittee chair, Mr. Millard, this week, he did say, I think it would make more sense if it was stationary or static.
Can't share with other schools.
Okay, that's the big committee. Okay? So now you know why it's important to keep reading these meetings. Now, I have, my next meeting was November 25th. You don't have this. This is on facilities. Do you mind if I go through this with you?
No, George, go ahead.
Go ahead, all right. The facility subcommittee, which is made up of Jill Hall, Bill Bernitsky, myself, I've attached myself to that committee, Hope Cafaro, Tom McKeon, Sherry Gray, and Mike Lazaro, or Grazzo, Grazzo, correct. Is it Lazaro? Okay. They met on the 25th at 6:30. Why did we meet? We met with two architects. And the architects were here to tell us some of the ideas that they had about what we should do to the school building in order, if it ever became a joint committee, I mean a joint school. Quisenberry Associates came and made a wonderful presentation, presented the committee with some wonderful ideas, and talked about state compliance and filing with the State Facilities Bureau, and went on and on. I think he, quite frankly, overwhelmed the subcommittee. Second architect, Mr. James Lawler, who is semi-retired architect, presented himself more as a consultant, was willing to work with the subcommittee to look at what we have, how many kids are we talking about, how much room are we going to need, short-term plan versus long-term plan. The committee liked him. He's going to be serving as a consultant to the subcommittee. The committee the full committee had approved $5,000 to engage the services of an architect. So Mr. Lawler will be working with that subcommittee. And the first task is to look at the enrollment and to try to find room in the building for those kids if they were to come, and who's left out in the hallway. So that's an interesting committee.
May I just add something to that? Also, as part of the discussion, was if you go back and look in the original reporting of Jonathan Costa about the statistics of the enrollments over the next few years, that there's, if they're true, a remarkable drop-off. So the question is, would it make sense to look at making all these changes, some of them quite dramatic, and then have it fall way off in a very short span of time? Would it not be better to wait? It's only a matter of 12 or 18 months that that happens before we spend all the money. Something else for consideration. There's always two sides to a pancake to look at when you're looking at making those kinds of changes.
Speaking of pancakes, the fiscal subcommittee met. That is made up of Mr. Chittum, Mr. Counter, Mr. Crone, Ms. Dyer, Ms. Millar, and Mr. Vosper. They met on December 3rd, and they talked about spreadsheets and their money people. So anyway, the long and the short that came out of that meeting is that Mr. Millar would meet with myself and Mr. Chittum, Superintendent Chittum and Colbert. And he did meet with me yesterday on the snow day. We had plenty of time to talk about, and Janet had provided all of our teachers, all of our budget broken out. So he can play the game of putting them together. And then once he puts them together, I think the plan is, I'm not sure, but I think the plan is for the fiscal subcommittee to say to the superintendent, well, how many teachers are you going to need to do this? And we're going to say 14. How many of this? How many of that? And he's going to come up with a budget that will meet the needs of Colebrook and Norfolk together in this building. And then they're going to expand it out into the future and say, this is how much it's going to cost 5 years from today. This is how much it costs now. And try to build it out. Any questions on that? I think that's what's going to happen. And the budget.
Happy with that for all of us?
Yeah, well, that one's in your file. And then there was Tuesday, the Norfolk Corvus budget, the budget subcommittee met on the 3rd. Mr. Millar prepared a document. It's intended to delineate the line item budgets and blah, blah, blah. So pretty much what I just said. He's still working to put that together. I think the next time the budget committee meets, he'll probably have what is being referred to as a pro forma budget, which would be Colebrook and Norfolk together and what we're spending. Now, he's going to, I think, at some point run into the wall because our benefits are better than their benefits for our people. Mm-hmm. But we'll let him work that out.
And particularly our parents probably and secretaries and so forth.
Yeah, we have paid holidays and paid a decent wage, and you're entitled to health benefits, and if you don't take them. But anyway, it'll all get washed out. So that's what's going on. So I'm going to try to keep you guys informed through these subcommittees because you can't attend them all. But you're going to be asked questions out there. Reporters don't attend the meeting, so it's hard to get the information out. So this is the best way that I think we could do it. Because this is the most important decision the town's made in 100 years. People ought to know what's going on. That's what I kind of figured. This is what's going on.
100 years, a little less.
Yeah. So, Jill, do you know that?
About 60.
Do you know the meeting dates? I think our next meeting
is the 18th.
The full committee.
The full committee, I believe, is the 18th.
12/18.
At 6:30 in Colebrook. At the Colebrook School. Let me check.
Governance is meeting tomorrow night. Tomorrow night. Sally's subcommittee is meeting tomorrow night on governance. Like, who's in charge?
What time is that meeting sound for?
6:30.
Here?
Mm-hmm.
In this room. Okay.
And who do you think is on your committee? You and Jeannie Jones and?
Our advisor.
Oh, you're on governance.
Sarah
on. All right.
Mike Skyners is on. Julie Schomburg is on.
Oh, what a meeting.
Larry Hannafin is on.
What a meeting.
We're going to have lots of fun.
That's tomorrow night?
No egg throwing or anything.
The 12th. So you're meeting on the 12th.
At 6:30. Would you like to come, George?
No. I'm going Christmas shopping. I'm going to be here Monday night. I'm going to be here Monday night at 6:30 with facilities.
Yes. I really do think we could have.
And then I'll be back again on Wednesday night, the 18th. So this is the timeline that the general committee came up with. All the subcommittees would complete their reports by April, and they would submit them to the full committee. The full committee would then approve those subcommittee reports or amend them and then approve them. But the subcommittees are going to be done by April. Full committee will vote on them in April. The full committee then would go to a town hearing to share all of these subcommittee reports, which I'm going to call the report. Mm-hmm. When all the subcommittees finish their work, it all comes together, they're going to go to the town hearing in May. Now, what else happens in May in this town? Budget. All right, full committee reacts to the town hearing. You go to a hearing, people say, this is the best plan I heard, this is the worst plan I heard, whatever. The full committee then goes back in May and reacts to the town hearing input. Assuming it's positive, they would vote then to submit the plan to the State Board of Education. That would be May of this year, of the coming year, 5 months from now. The plan would be submitted to the State Board of Ed in June. The State Board has 30 days by law to respond to the proposal. Assuming the state approves it, they would send it back to the full committee by August, and the town would have 45 to 90 days by law to vote on a referendum from the date that the state approved it. Now, I'm saying August might be earlier or later. So...
To vote on whether to have a referendum?
No, no, you would take the plan, that full plan that the state approved, said you guys up there did a really good job with this, we're approving it.
To regionalize Norfolk and Colton.
It would come back to the full committee, Norfolk would call for a referendum, Colebrook would call for a referendum. As best we know, both towns would then have to approve. If one voted up or down, it would fail. The town referendum was talked about in November. Now, I think the governor's race is in November of the coming year, so I think it's tied around a statewide fall election.
But it's one referendum, right?
The referendum in both would be both towns.
And is that on the same day? Each town has a referendum, and Norfolk would have it on the day, the 10th, and...
If it's tied into the gubernatorial fall election date, it would be on that ballot, November ballot. That's talked about. This is still, the timeline.
This is a very ambitious...
Now, if both towns approved it, you would have between November of 2014 and August of 2015 to do the planning, and the students would arrive at their new school in September of 2015. And everybody talked that this is really ambitious, you're kidding me? They felt it to be doable. Now, I'm not saying I felt it was to be doable, the full committee said it was doable.
And the idea is to do it fast, super fast, because it will save us money faster. Is that...
No, that I didn't hear that.
Why? I would say that's the reason to do it.
At an ambitious time.
It wasn't talked about.
They didn't get into that. Now, one of the other things, when they make this comparative of budgets between Norfolk and Colebrook that Mike kind of referenced tonight, they're going to use our chart of accounts in breaking out two budgets. There'll be more to follow on that. One of the things that the full committee talked about was a rotating schedule of special teachers, where art, music, phys ed, science, if there's going to be, math, if there's going to be, would somehow rotate, as opposed to saying every Wednesday afternoon is going to be music. We're going to have PE on Tuesday, Thursday. This week you may have to, one of the schedules has, you might have phys ed this week, Tuesday, Thursday, but at some other time it might be Monday, Wednesday.
But didn't we go back to say that
That hasn't been nailed down.
No. Yeah.
Everybody seems to think that a static schedule, where one that doesn't change, would be a lot easier for the whole world.
Right.
But it didn't. That's still.